a nephew tried to explain what the skibbity toilet thing was to me, and he showed me it on his iPad, and I thought I was hallucinating. It's terrifying what the iPad generation is doing.
Welcome to the Ecom Chats Happy Hour Podcast.
I'm Mike Martis, Director of Marketing at Finch.
And I'm Nevin Zavell, e-commerce product specialist at Finch.
And this is your e-commerce podcast to wind down the week, crack open a cold one, and talk some shop. We've got our mics. We've got our drinks. We're ready to go today. Excited. We're going to zoom out just a little bit. We've been talking about Q4 a lot. We're still going to talk about Q4. Like, we're going to talk about this in relation to Q4. But we're going to zoom out a little bit and take a look at the market overall. There's an Accenture Song report that came out that had a lot of good tidbits in it. So we're both data people, so this should be a good conversation.
And this is like the exact time I like talking about 2024, because it can get really, really tough sometimes trying to separate your personal biases away from next year's predictions. Because we live in such a heavily algorithm-driven world. A lot of us who are, you know, current events from like Twitter, TikTok, and things like that, who are kind of absorbing trends, you can really easily get trapped in a bubble of what you're seeing, and can really affect your lens. So I normally like to make my predictions a little bit early in the year and then wait to be either validated or challenged by these big State of the Unions that are coming out. So we've seen a couple major trends, you know, big guys in the league, Accenture released theirs, McKinsey, BCG, a lot of these big consulting firms are starting to release their States of the Union. And now is a really good time to start talking about 2024, because marketers right now are kind of stuck in this rock and a hard place of like, okay, we got Q4 in full swing. And I feel like one of those professors, like, the exam is coming. If you have not already studied for it, you can try and put something together now, but brace yourself. So if you haven't, highly encourage you to go back to our previous series on Q4, where we talk about segmentation, promotion strategy, overall planning, how to do some of the tactics to approach Q4. So if you haven't put a strategy together yet for Q4, I don't know why, but please go back and listen and try and put something together before the exam.
You're not running out of time. You are out of time.
Yeah. So we want to kind of zoom out and look at, as Mike was saying, we want to look at the year 2024 and kind of see what's ahead, because I'm not going to lie, it's a little bit depressing seeing some of the predictions and analysis that are coming out from 2024, seeing a lot of good movement about the holiday season in 2023, which is going to be great, because I feel like brands are really going to have to start preparing for what might be a really hard year. You know, we've already seen inflation really hitting hard in 2023, started to level off a little bit, but maybe not by much. I was just reading that, like, what the interest rates are, what, like 8% right now for like buying a home, like mortgage rates are 8%.
I'm currently in the process of looking to buy a place, and yeah, it's not anything to be optimistic about, but
I am holding on to my place with my 2% rate with my like dying breath.
Okay, man. Okay. You don't have to rub it in.
I will. But we're noticing, because of this, we're starting to see a period in a marketing that we haven't really seen in a while. And this is leading to some trends that we want to talk about. And, you know, we're not Chapo. We're not PodSafe. We don't want to start to super analyze a lot of the geopolitics of the world right now.
If you're really interested, I'm sure you could take a look at either of our social profiles and figure it out. But this is not the platform for us to talk about our own political leanings or anything like that. We're talking about what the market is telling us about sentiments.
Yeah, we want to start looking at how these conditions and how these situations are affecting consumer behavior. And a couple early trends that we're seeing that I really wanted to touch on is that consumer friction, you know, friction between brands and consumers is really starting to rise. And there's a couple key drivers of that. And one of them that has been kind of around for a while is rising prices and either lower quality or quantity of products. And this is something that consumers are becoming a lot more sensitive to now than previously, just because there's a lot more economic strains on consumers to make the right purchasing decision. So normally what I notice in the market is that when you start seeing when interest rates are low, money is cheap, and there's a lot more consumer dollars in the market, people are more willing to take risks. That's why, you know, in the coronavirus pandemic, a lot more D2C brands really started to flourish. Things like Casper and Purple Mattresses, Allbirds, a lot of these direct-to-consumer brands really took off. And near the end of the pandemic, when things started to open up, we started seeing a lot of these brands really start to take a beating, because we start to see things like supply chain issues. We start to see that consumer demand start to tighten. But when that consumer demand tightens, we tend to see it center around brands that they already know and love. And it's not necessarily that people aren't buying, but it is that they are buying safer. And because of that, when you start to see things like, you know, shrinkflation, I think the new term on the market is tipflation now that everyone spins an iPad around. And
everybody's got a flation take over here.
Yeah. but we're starting to see, as companies are starting to cut costs, as brands are starting to really kind of tighten the reins, that does have an effect on consumer quality. Now, if we look at a lot, what sets a lot of these giants apart, like Amazon and big competitors that have become giants, is that they are consumer obsessed. They are customer obsessed at the cost of almost anything else.
Just to put a fine point on it, Nevin, we've got our first stat of the podcast straight from the Accenture report. To put a little bit of a fine point around this, it says, you know, 37% of people worldwide think that many companies are prioritizing higher profits over better customer experience. And if you've listened to this podcast before, first of all, thank you. That's awesome. Keep listening. We love you. But you know how much we talk. We had an episode with our CEO that in talking about the importance of a customer experience and customer experience throughout the life cycle. It doesn't start when they buy and it doesn't end when they buy. You know, it's a longer life cycle than that. But to put that in context, though, 40% of CXOs say they plan to raise prices to pass cost increases to customers. So, you know, these are essentially supporting each other. The assumptions that about 40% of people have match the reality of the 40% of businesses that say, yeah, we're absolutely doing that. And that's where you're seeing this uncertainty and distrust. There's a lot of distrust, and building that trust is a customer experience project.
Right now, people are sensitive to this, because if people are starting to see that they are getting a lower quality product and then they're seeing a tweet that the earnings call of the company that makes that product are through the roof, people are going to find something else because people are going to be pissed, right? People are already being strapped for cash higher, so they're going to go find a brand that might do better. So right now, it's important when you're trying to look at your retention to be the exception, not the rule. To be the company that stands out for still having incredible customer service and to still have an incredible consumer experience from end to end, rather than the company that's like looking to try and shake you down for more money and give you a lower profit, because people will move on.
Yeah, just to be very clear about it here, I mean, we don't just live in this little digital recording studio talking about e-commerce. We're in the world, we understand, and you are too. There's a buzzword that's been thrown around for a few years now, and maybe even a little bit longer, but it's really picked up steam in the zeitgeist, which is late stage capitalism. You do not want to be lumped in to any kind of conversation of people talking about the problems and the woes of what is being termed late stage capitalism, because that's what this feels. And it's a very dystopian type of, the companies are taking advantage of us, the kleptocracy, all this stuff gets lumped into those loaded statements. You don't want to be a part of those.
I'll make it easier. And this is something that I saw on Twitter recently, because we are out in the world, and it's the concept of inshittification. Which is a little bit easier on the tongue than late-stage capitalism. But when we start talking about the concept of inshittification, where two great examples that I can give is one that's a bit of a personal example and one that's an example out in the market. I use, because I love to cook, I use a meal delivery service. Over time, the quality that I have seen of the schedule and cadence of deliveries and of the actual qualities of the orders has started to really deteriorate over the past couple months, right? So orders either just not arriving on time, not getting packaged properly so that there's like soy sauce all over the inside of the packet. Like, I got real food poisoning once from it, because there was one that was supposed to be like steak tips, cooked it, and turns out that the bag was punctured during transit, so the meat was contaminated and exposed. I got really sick. So over time, I'm starting to look back and I'm like, okay, the prices are not being adjusted. I'm looking to see, is this something that I can continue to expect? And after a while, yeah, I just switched to a different provider, because why would I continue to go through, and why would I continue to, again, have a shittier product that used to be great, but over time just could not keep up with the market demand and just started to deteriorate. Another great example is one that's fascinating has been in the gaming industry. You know, I'm a big gamer. And that's one of the, you know, we are out in the world. We have, you know, our niches. And one thing I've really noticed in the gaming space is that there has been a trend that's starting to pull out in 2023, thank God. But there has been a major trend of a lot of these larger game developers having a very publicly worse conditions for their developers, raising prices. Like, I think the new Call of Duty is what, like $70 compared to $60. So they're raising prices. And when a lot of these games launch, they're broken on launch. So this is a trend that we're seeing that kind of crosses from everything from food service to digital products like video games. And it's something that has been, as the economy has started to shrink, as the things have started to slow down, you start to see a lot of companies either trying to cut costs or loosen the standards on what they're delivering. And that is something that, like Mike said, is so toxic to get lumped into. So this is where we kind of will show that, you know, one thing I really want to follow up is with a lot of these sort of very kind of doomsaying predictions, there's a lot of opportunities attached here. And because if we're starting to see global trends, right, having your brand be the exception, not the rule, allows you to stand out from the crowd. And I think that segues really into the second topic, unless you had anything to add to that one, Mike.
No, other than, you know, without naming names, I've experienced the exact thing in the gaming industry. Look, it's really difficult to put yourself into the position of an executive at a huge company that's making decisions. You know, they've got to hit budgets. They've got to save money. And the issue that consumers have is that a lot of times those decisions are paid for on the back of the consumer and not through better business dealings and decisions by the company. Right. And so that's what we're really trying to say here is if you come up to a point in your e-commerce business where the options are develop a better customer service apparatus or charge more for your products, that should be an easy decision for you. It should be the latter or the former every time. Those are the kind of companies, if we're quite honest, that we like to do business with because it matches the way we market and the way that we make decisions about how much money you should spend and where you should spend it. If we have clients that, and we know that they have bad customer service or we're not able to get people to come back, that's the main indicator. We can't get people to come back and buy again. That's a big problem. And we've talked about how your revenue engine needs that return. It's that sponge squeeze. If you can't squeeze the sponge after filling it because your customer service was shit, you're doing poorly, right? You have a problem that needs to be fixed and it can't be fixed by just charging more for your products.
The other flip side of this is to maintain product quality, because the other side of this is that people are getting very, very sensitive to what they feel to be cut corners. So this is honestly looking at 2024 ahead, it feels like it is more of a time to invest in your apparatus for long-term gains rather than short-term cash grabs. And I know that that can be a lot easier said than done in, you know, today's business culture. However, when we start to look at where you want to invest as a product with whatever funds that you have, investing in the customer experience will always deliver better dividends long-term than whatever switching to a cheaper manufacturer or cutting some QA process will deliver in the short term. So again, it requires a lot of hard work, but to really figure out where you want to invest is customer service department for sure, making sure that when you're talking to someone, you're getting someone who is genuine, who is well-trained, who is, you know, not stiff, rigid, reading a script, but somebody who can actually help solve your problems. And I mean, that should be first one to invest in. The second should obviously be investing and making sure that you continually have a high quality product that stands apart from the competition. And number three is to make sure that that is something that you can communicate through your advertising, right? Is that you communicate that you have a solid customer experience from start to finish. It's something that you can absolutely brag about, is that, you know, we have a world-class customer service team. Amex literally built a brand off of this. Like, Amex's brand is that when you call Amex for customer service, you get taken care of and you get treated like a king. So those kind of brands right now, brands that are famous for treating their customers well through the entire process, and I know it's something that we hammer almost every episode, those are the brands that are going to make it through 2024 and not just survive, but thrive. Because those are the brands that when people start shrinking who they're shopping with and stop experimenting with new brands, they're going to fall back to the brand that treated them the best. You know, whatever industry you're in, whether it's e-commerce, whether it's like meal delivery or meal prep, gaming, whatever you is, if you have a product and you have a customer experience around that product, investing in those is always going to pay the biggest dividends long term. Even if it might be a rougher 2024, as things start to accelerate again, as things start to heat up again, as we start moving kind of outside of this economic wacky zone, that is where you're going to start to see your biggest long-term dividends pay out. But I think we've probably hammered this topic to death over the past 6 weeks.
But it was nice to see in the Accenture report kind of our message here kind of reestablished, or at least backed up by some data and some larger reporting, because we've been feeling it. It's been an ethos of ours for a while. Our customer success team is really what drives the engagement here. Now, we have a service company, so it's different from what kind of customer success you should have as a direct consumer brand, but it's still, the main points are the same. The report had some things to say about media, right? Some stagnation. There's another nation. Some stagnation happening in the media landscape. What'd you see there?
And this is one that I actually feel really vindicated about, because this was one of those where I thought I was going insane and it was just me. But it is a lot of boredom and stagnation in media as a whole. This is not just in like the advertising space, but this extends into movies, into cinema, into television, into music. There is a large scale boredom in media right now where, you know, and I personally have felt this myself, is that it is consistently remakes, rehashes, sequels. Thank God for Martin Scorsese. I'm going to go see Killers of the Flower Moon this weekend. I'm very, very excited to see Martin Scorsese save cinema again. But it is a consistently taking the safe angle and rehashing something. I mean, Disney is starting to lose steam, but there is a boredom and there is a fixation. And what you see a lot of this is where it starts to reflect in social media, where you start to see, like, for example, on things like TikTok, the trends on TikTok that are starting to flourish and starting to really grow are ones that are a little bit more postmodern, that are a little bit more unhinged. They had a nephew try to explain what the skibbity toilet thing was to me, and he showed me it on his iPad, and I thought I was hallucinating. It's terrifying what the iPad generation is doing. But like, a lot of these things are starting to resonate more and more and becoming incredibly popular are things that are playing it less safe. And I think that although we're not talking to Hollywood executives, but there is a nugget to be learned in that people are starting to get bored with the blandness of the ecosystem, is that for your advertising, risks can pay off. And this is something where if there is a bland background, it is so much easier to stick out. Because if everybody is trying to do the same basic trends and trying to follow on the same basic rising and falling hype trains, being able to stand apart from the background puts you front and center more.
Yeah, I have a real world example of this, Nevin, actually. A previous company that I worked for, they helped SaaS startups essentially get to a funding stage, right? And what was interesting was we were running LinkedIn ads, like targeted LinkedIn ads, and we had like 5 or 6 campaigns going. And the one that absolutely killed compared to the other ones, it was literally, the ad was a rectangle image that was yellow, and it just said, get funded for your next SaaS phase or whatever. That's all it said. I mean, and that, literally that's all it said. If you clicked on it, it went to our landing page. It absolutely destroyed the other ones. And the other ones were your run of the mill advertisements, right? That you see 150 of every time you log into a social media platform. The one that worked for us was that one. The issue is we tried to replicate it with, you know, different colors will work better, maybe blah, 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 you know, and all this. And they kind of plateaued, like the results plateaued. But what we did learn is that seemed to be refreshing in the market. And by the way, this was a few years ago at this point. So this has been a trend in the media landscape for quite a while. I know, you know, you go online and you can find whole message boards that are completely dedicated to complaining about live action remakes of Disney classics, to bring it back to an example of what you're doing. Like, we've already seen this movie. Why are you making it with just different animation? You know what I mean? So, you know, we've already seen this. What are you doing? So one thing that I always try to do is to be unexpected, right? I think that's the main thing. If you can make your media and messaging a bit unexpected, that'll make it stand out, whether that's through the design, the creative, or through the messaging and the language that you use. That, I think that's the main takeaway.
Creativity and kind of guerrilla marketing campaigns can be effective. One that I've seen that is absolutely killing it is Domino's. Because Domino's did a really, really fun one. I don't know if you've seen the Domino's student loans, but they are piggybacking on a lot of the legislation happening around student loan debt. And what they are doing is they are giving you the ability to apply for a free pizza if you have student loans. And you can get a free pizza from Domino's if you have student loans. It is great, though, because the thing is that it is an email capture and marketing capture form, where if you have student loans, you can go to Domino's, put in your email. There is a box in there that you are accepting to be contacted again for marketing materials, and you get a free pizza out of it. That pizza probably cost them nothing to make, but now you have somebody who is email captured in with a free pizza because they feel like they have their back where they're drowning in student loan debt. They can go and get a free pizza out of it, and Domino's has their back. That is something that is great because it works on so many different levels, right? You are getting people a product in hand, a taste of the pizza. You know, I mean, if you haven't had Domino's pizza at this point, like, I don't know what rock you've been living under, but you're getting people to have good feelings about you, that you're taking a positive stand on like a social justice issue. You're able to actually like stand as like one of the good guys. Your people accept it because you're giving them free stuff, and you're also getting lead capture so that marketing down the line, you can hit them with push notifications about pizza. It's incredibly smart and it works in all different angles and it runs incredibly cheaply. There's been some advertising on it, but it's taken off with UGC on TikTok and on social media of like, hey, here's how you can get Domino's to give you a free pizza if you have student loan debt. Another one that I always found fascinating, and I use this one as an example through most of my college years, so I'm kind of dating myself, has been Riot Games and League of Legends. Now, I'm 12 months sober from League of Legends. Haven't touched the game in forever. I'm sorry. It's terrible for your mental health. But everything surrounding League of Legends is really, really cool, because what Riot Games does is they invest in media, but what they really do that's always funny is every year they make a virtual band, because League of Legends is a free game, so you sell skins. But what they do is they put together a virtual band of different characters within the game, and they have big name stars behind them. Like this one, they have a huge K-pop star headlining. It's a boy band around like lineup of characters that they want to start pushing. And every single time you start to see the sales data from these, they started with like a K-pop group that was like actually big name K-pop stars that were just, again, a virtual band of these characters in game. And the skins for these things were like, I think they were like $20, and they sold like hotcakes. They were like, I think, some of the most popular skin lines ever, because they're able to generate buzz. Now, it was definitely, this is a lot more expensive than a couple free pizzas. But at the end of the day, they are huge. Like, I'm looking, the latest one, let me pull the stats.
Yeah, and there's also Nick Scott did like a live concert in one of
Travis Scott, yeah, in Fortnite.
Or Travis Scott,
so
yeah.
It's, and obviously we're not in the gaming sector. It's just, we're nerds. So
but they do, I mean, look, we like to call out when good marketing happens, right? Because there are always lessons to be learned whenever you see good marketing campaigns.
And I think the main takeaway from a lot of these examples is that thinking outside the box and taking risks, even if they might be big ones, has the potential to pay off and turn into marketing strategies that you can continuously use and deploy. So when we're talking about advertising, there's always like kind of the humdrum Google search ads creatives. Being creative, particularly around your creative strategy in a world where everything can be feel incredibly bland, is taking risks can pay off. And at the end of the day, yeah, not all of them are going to pan out. But as a company, especially in times where you have rougher economic conditions, the instinct is to play it safe. But when everybody else is playing it safe, whoever is able to go out there and take a gamble on a new strategy, a new creative messaging, a risk, will get paid out. And those more than likely can turn into ways to stand apart from a crowd in an audience that is getting incredibly bored of the same five commercials playing on loop every time they tune in
football. Which is crazy, Nevin, because when you think about like this next point we want to make, it kind of ties into this. If people kind of feel like they're losing pace with like how fast technology is advancing, the issue is right now it seems like in the marketing space, technology is advancing to the point where it's making creative so easy to make, but it's very formulaic. So it ends up looking really similar when you use AI to create your creative. And then the ad platforms you push them into, they're going to surface ones that look like others that have won in the past, which, you know, it feeds into this. Why am I seeing the same stuff, the same types of ads, the same stuff over and over again? Plus, you know, everybody's algorithms are different. So, you know, depending on what you've interacted with online before and what kind of products you look at. When I was growing up, it was a dystopian conversation to have of, oh, the internet is tracking everything you do and privacy is dead. Now it's kind of a reality. People just accept it, right? Like if you're online, your information is available. And what people end up doing with that and the technology that advances to utilize that information more effectively, it does get to feel like, and as a marketer, I feel this myself, there are so many new marketing tools and so many new AI-driven parts of old tools that are getting updated. Everything feels like it's changing super, super fast. And again, and it's easy to feel like you're getting left behind.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, right now it does feel a little bit dystopian, but a lot of these areas that can feel a little bit dystopian can be massive opportunities for brands to grow. Listen, this is one that, you know, we're humans too, that we feel that massive onset of technology. Like right now we're looking at trying to come to grips with AI as it comes out, and ChatGPT becomes one of the most adopted pieces of software within like a year of launch, right? It already becomes second nature. So things are moving incredibly quickly, and it really puts an onus on brands to adapt rapidly. And that, especially when times are tough, can be very, very challenging, but it is more important than ever to continually adapt because interfaces are changing. And I think, I don't know if we can really touch on the whole AI subject without making an entire episode about it. So we'll just put a bookend and talk about AI at some point in a full episode. To put it briefly, search platforms are moving in an AI-focused direction. Google is already experimenting with rolling out Bard as its primary interface. ChatGPT is already heavily integrated into Bing. So we're already starting to see the main search engine start to really turn to AI interface. And there's a lot of things that you can do there, primarily making sure that your product data in your things like your data feeds and on your landing pages is as accurate as possible, and to make sure you're feeding high-quality data into these algorithms. But as these things continue to grow, and one of the big changes that we're going to be seeing in 2024 is that interfaces and how we interact are slowly changing. I think as things like mixed reality and augmented reality, not necessarily talking about like the whole Mark Zuckerberg metaverse or whatever there, but I'm more talking about the ability to like preview items in your home by looking through your phone and using like the augmented reality camera on like your iPhone. Maybe as like these virtual reality headsets become cheaper, that might have a play in it too. I'm a little bit more skeptical about the things like the metaverse than things more like AI. But as we start to see how AI has already changed the way that we operate as brands, as companies, and as consumers, I think that there's a lot of gold in the way that we're going to start moving away from the keyword-packed titles and keyword-packed product pages of like everything needs to be hyper-SEO optimized to more how things are going to unfold in a little bit more of a conversational messaging strategy that can be picked up by something like Bard, that can be picked up by something like ChatGPT to better serve and deliver content. And I can't necessarily fully predict how that is going to be playing out. I think a next episode will be great to go and kind of talk about how we expect AI to change. I know we're coming a little bit late to the game on that one. But I feel like that is the best opportunity. If people are getting very, very bored and bland now of the media ecosystem that we're currently in, new technologies to come and shake that up, like AI, are prime examples of where people can really innovate. I think the last big shakeup we saw was like short form video content like Instagram Reels, YouTube Shorts, TikTok, and things of that nature. That was a huge boom in being able a whole new channel to start delivering content, to start delivering messaging. I think AI is that next big shakeup that we're going to start to see. I think a lot of people are already using it, but using that kind of technology to change the way that people interface, I think is going to be the next big step. And that's what we're going to start to see unfold rapidly in 2024.
Yep. And just to recap a little bit here, we're running up on time, but basically for out of the Accenture report, and this is going to mirror a lot of other big market reports that you look at, customer friction is rising. The friction between customer expectations and what they get from the companies they do business with, that friction is rising as consumers view the companies as taking advantage of them in times of economic insecurity, which is very not cool in the eyes of the consumer. So we're seeing the consumer friction rising. We're seeing media kind of weirdly stagnating into kind of these AI-driven mind meld looking kind of all vanilla type of media. So take that and do something different is what we're saying. And also, you know, people are feeling like they're running behind on technology, right? That's just, it's happening way too fast for everyone to keep up with. I seem like every time I get used to one tool, one marketing tool, it either completely changes because they release a whole AI section of their tool, or 15 competitors come out that do it better because they're utilizing AI better. So it's wild out here. So a lot of our preconceived notions being confirmed here in this report. But the question is, like, what are we saying that you should do about it? Yeah, I got a few things, got a few bullet points. First of all, invest in putting the customer first, always. We're going to tell you that anyway, no matter what, but it's even more important given what we're learning from these market sentiment reports. People want to feel like they're special. They want to feel like you value them, and you do, because they are giving you money. So you should make them feel like they're valued. So you want to invest in long-term customer service, customer experience programs that may not pay dividends until next year or 6 months or 8 months out, but they will pay dividends, I promise. And creativity and ingenuity will be recognized in this market. If you do something creative and take a risk, it's going to get recognized, and you should absolutely feel emboldened. As long as you have the team in place and budget to do it, absolutely go after something creative, step out of your comfort zone. One thing in college that I learned, and what we've been talking about a little bit here, watch commercials and look at advertisements and the marketing ecosystem of other industries. Because a lot of times you can find cool ways to translate those into what you're doing and your product set and your company ethos. And that's what a lot of the kind of higher level marketing companies do a lot of times, is we had this campaign that was really successful for this soda brand. Let's go ahead and do something similar for this truck brand. Maybe that'll work, right? And like so keep these types of things in mind, because there are real effects in the market for being stagnant with your creative. But anything to add to that before I kick us into the weekend, Nevin?
Well, I know that things change rapidly, especially in the marketing ecosystem. But there is one thing in the marketing world that does not change. And that is the weekend. So
that's,
I want to
right.
give a big shout out to
the fact that we love the Weekenders. I love that you're on board with the Weekenders. That's awesome to me. We're available wherever you get your podcasts. Visit finch.com/podcast for more content. Engage with us on Twitter at @finch_PPC, Facebook at facebook.com/finch.ecommerce. And we're on LinkedIn as well. You can find us just by searching the name. Until next time, I'm Mike Martis.
And I'm Nevin.
And we'll catch you next Friday.
You guys, and I'm Nevin Zavell.
His microphone died on him. Right on, guys. We'll see you next time.